where we seek out the man at the musical helm of the movie Titanic.
Yes, Brooke, thank you. Hello. This is the flip side from London, where the much-anticipated follow-up, the sequel to the soundtrack album of Titanic, is released this week. Well, composer James Horner has already sold 25 million copies of that album worldwide, and will this one do as well?
For his new work, Back to Titanic, Horner came to London's Air Studios to record with the London Symphony Orchestra. The centerpiece of the work is the newly composed Titanic Suite and Epilogue, The Deep and Timeless Sea, two symphonic works that include major themes from the film's score.
Tremendous responsibility I feel on my shoulders that the album has to be at least as good as the first one for me emotionally and sort of ring true and hopefully be better than the first one. And I think musically it might be better than the first one. Whether it's as well received as the first one, I don't know. I don't have the benefit of the film coming out when the album comes out. But I think that there's a chance that this will be, for me, a better, more emotional, satisfying album than the first one.
How easy was it for Horner to create music without pictures for Back to Titanic? Did he have a story for the sequel in his mind?
The focus of the second album is I have to take somebody off the street and dramatically pull them out of 1997, 1998, pull them back in time, pull them down, and recreate this world. And I do it in about, takes me about 18 minutes, and I cast this spell. And luckily, if I'm lucky enough, a listener will then listen to the album, be involved in what happened in Titanic, and then obviously things take a turn for the worse, and the album reflects that. And then at the end, I wrote this sort of epilogue, which encapsulates the whole feeling of the whole thing.
Norwegian singing star Sissel, whose haunting voice is a feature of the Titanic soundtrack, the new work inevitably conjures up images of the film.
For me, when I listen to it, it comes, the different scenes pops up, and but it's even bigger, the music is even bigger. It's because this time we have the boys choir singing, it's real boys choir, and everything is so huge and it's so warm that I just feel like this is music. This is more music than the film. You understand what I'm meaning? Because he's now James can written without thinking of the movie.
Even if you mightn't have seen the film, I'm sure you've heard a lot of this around. I mean, of course, Celine's gorgeous song has been around the world, and a lot of that, even melodic substance, is in the score, the orchestral work. So I think as a CD, it's going to hold together beautifully.
The incredible success of the Titanic soundtrack has raised hopes at Sony Classical, the record company responsible for Titanic, that this is the way to introduce classical works to a far wider audience than might otherwise be interested. Is film soundtrack music the new home of classical music?
Well, I come out of the classical world, and I've got to say that for me, writing serious classical music, writing a Te Deum or a Requiem or a Mass or something, is just absurd in this day and age, because no one is going to see it, and no one's going to pay for it, and no one's going to buy rehearsal time, and the musicians' union isn't going to let you record for free, and you'll never get a it's just impossible. Whereas writing for film, the downside is you work for an employer, and you have to pay homage to who you're working for. The upside is that if you're clever, you can write some wonderful music and get it heard and performed by marvelous musicians, where you could never get that in a million years with writing a serious piece.